Right, good afternoon, everyone. It's a great pleasure to be here, and many thanks to Best of Heritage for the invitation. Now, it strikes me one of the benefits of being later on in the programme and this sort of event win is that you actually get the benefit of hearing what everyone else has said. So I think it's fair to say that this project I'm about to run through contains elements of quite a number of the other projects. Because while I'm going to focus primarily on transforming the building and the displays and reusing the collections.
I'm sorry, sir, you're native. Most of us aren't, so...
All right, I'm afraid we in Scotland tend to speak too quickly.
So please.
So I shall slow down.
Thank you. You will have two minutes more. Yeah.
So alongside this transforming the building, we were also transforming the organisation. I was very interested in our colleague from China talking about the approach to visitors and thinking about the facilities they would need and how to care for them. Think about how the organisation needed to be reshaped to deliver a better service for visitors. So all these things were going on alongside what we're doing. But basically, this was a project to transform a very traditional national museum. It was a museum that first opened in 1866. And over the 150 years after that, it had been changed a little bit here and a little bit there. But really, it had lost sight of what its purpose was. And when I arrived as director 10 years ago, it was just a few years after a new extension had been constructed in the Museum of Scotland, which contained displays about the history of Scotland and its people. So when I arrived, I said to quite a number of the staff, well, you've completed this wonderful new modern building about Scotland and its internal history. So what's the building next door about? And it was quite interesting that no one could really tell me the answer. There wasn't really a vision for what this museum now was. The reaction from visitors, what was that they found it a bit of a muddle. There's a huge wide range of collections, as I'll come back to in a moment. They also said that new visitors tended to say they got lost in the building, they couldn't find their way out. Now, while some may think that's a good thing in a museum, some of the visitors certainly didn't agree with that. So really, what we had to essentially do was to reinvent the museum. And what we did was very much create an entirely new museum within a wonderful Victorian museum building. It's not something that happened overnight. I was interested in the comment just made about how long it takes to do a new building. Well, I can assure you that transforming an old building takes equally long. So, this was the, I suppose my starting point is also the end point. This was the scene at about 9:30 in the morning on the day the museum reopened after being part closed for 3 1/4 years. At this point, there were something like 5,000 people waiting outside to get in. There were something like 22,000 people visited in a single day on the day we reopened. And really, I guess what I want to do is give an insight into why was that so? Why was there so much anticipation of the museum reopening? So this is the museum and the plan here. What you've got here is the museum in the centre of the old town in Edinburgh, a World Heritage Site. On the right-hand side of this block here is a new building constructed, opened in 1998. And all of this is the Victorian building, which was constructed in three phases between 1866 and 1888. So the part we actually closed was everything to the left of the line here. All of this was closed for 3 3/4 years. It's a very large museum site. It's one of the largest museums in the UK. And it's by some way the largest museum outside London. But we couldn't do it all at the one time. After I arrived as director, we created a master plan for the whole complex. But we also realised we could never hope to raise the money, because there wasn't any money at this point. And we couldn't hope to execute it all as a single phase, because we couldn't really close the new extension that had just been opened. So we were really forced into doing the project in three phases. The first phase cost about 15 million euros, undertaken between 2004 and 2006. The second phase is the one I'm talking about here, which cost about 60 million euros. And we're now hard at work on the third phase, which is another 15 million euros, and is completing in 2016. So it's part of a much larger project. Before we could do anything, we had to actually move some things off-site, because in addition to the public galleries, we also used the museum as storage. And we moved something in the order of 2.4 million items from the museum to a storage site. National Museum of Scotland as a whole has about 4 million items in its collections. I also found that our conservation team were dotted around the building as well, which didn't seem terribly sensible given the stored collections were split between two sites and the rest of their colleagues were somewhere else. So again, they moved as well. But what were the things we needed to look at? Well, there was a clear need for change. On the left of this screen, you can see the front of the building as it was pretty much when I arrived as director. The front of this wonderful Victorian building was used for car parking by staff. There was a wonderful grand flight of Victorian stairs, a wonderful bit of architecture, but unfortunately hopeless, no good if you had a pushchair, you know, wheelchair, or you couldn't climb stairs. So quite difficult for many members of the public who were directed round to the rear of the building to come in. There were also major issues with the building, as you can see in the right-hand side of the screen. The roofs leaked, so there were buckets to catch the water. The displays were also very old. I particularly like the display at the right-hand side, just at the very end, where you can see more labels than you can objects. So there was major issues with the building. There was also major issues with the displays. Displays were very old. The oldest display was at least 75 years old, and that is the one on the left. In fact, you may just be able to make out, in the centre here, this is a whale skeleton which had been there since the museum opened in 1866. But so very old displays. On the right-hand side was what at that point was called the main hall, which we renamed the Grand Gallery of the museum, a wonderful Victorian structure with cast iron pillars, wooden roof timbers, a glass roof. However, in the 1960s, someone had the bright idea to insert some fish ponds in the middle. So there were two fish ponds in this wonderful Victorian structure, totally incongruous, but they were very popular, and they proved to be quite a talking point because the plan was to take them out. My director of marketing used to have sleepless nights about this, worried about all the complaints we were going to receive. And my line was always, don't worry about it. They're popular because they're the only thing that moves in the whole building. Because there was no interaction in any of the galleries. It was very static, very, very old-fashioned and traditional. And my view was always, well, I'm not surprised the children like the fish because that's all there is for them to do in the whole museum. But we actually, as I'll come back to in a second, we actually took them out. But there was also other issues as well. We used spaces in the buildings, as I said, to store objects. Terrible conditions. I mean, any curators in the audience will throw their hands up in horror at the storage on the left-hand side, which has been accumulated over a century or more. Terrible conditions for the objects. All that material went off to a new storage building. On the right-hand side, you can see a single space for education, learning, study programs, a very, very small room for an enormous complex. Again, these facilities went up to scratch. So a huge amount of work had to take place, but what were we really aiming to achieve? And I think there's three things we can say there. The first is to restore the building itself. We recognised at a very early stage the building itself was our largest object in the collection. A wonderful grade A listed Victorian building, but really had been neglected over the years. Secondly, the collections really had to be rediscovered and revisited. Because again, the significance of parts of the collection were just not appreciated, because I think endless directors had their own ideas and staff had their ideas here and there. But no one really seemed to have a strong picture of the overall importance and significance of all of the collection. Third, and perhaps most importantly, visitors. There was very little focus on our visitors at all. And what we really wanted to do fundamentally was to reinvent this museum such that it had a very strong visitor focus at its very heart. So we talked a few moments ago about how long it takes to do projects. Well, this is the timeline for the current phase of the project, starting in 2004 and ending in 2011. The new galleries we're working on now will open in 2016. So these things do not happen overnight. So how did it all look? Well, a quick insight into some of the major works involved. Part of the project involved creating a new public space, that was level with the street outside, such that you could walk in on a level basis or push your wheelchair or buggy in without having to go up the stairs, but also to provide new public facilities. So it was a huge engineering job, as you can see by this image here. And that's how it looks now, with these new openings and entrance created in the street. You can also get a sense of how large the museum is, because basically it's end-to-end on the left-hand side of this image. And it's on, well, one part's four levels and one part's seven levels, so it's very large. But if you went through that doorway on the left-hand side, you'd have gone into this space. This is how it looked during construction. This had never, ever been a public space. It was used, first of all, for workshops, building engineering models, and then later for some of the storage I showed a few slides earlier. So this is how it looked part of the way through, and that's how it looks today. A new entrance hall with new visitor facilities, with cloakroom, toilets, shop, one of three restaurants, facilities for schools to leave bags and picnic lunches and so on. From there, visitors ascend to the Grand Gallery. So this is how it looked during a work in progress. In the center, you can just see some of the pipe work that was put in for the fish ponds, which have now gone. And it's worth saying, by the way, just an aside, my director of marketing was worrying completely unnecessarily, because to this day, I've never had a letter of complaint about it, which is quite interesting. So that's how it looked at that point, and that's how it looks today. The whole idea here was to create a hub at the center of the museum, which in fact is what it was originally meant to be, this space. We deliberately left it quite open on the floor. As you can, I think, see here, there's about 10 large objects with significant stories attached to them. But I'll touch on in a few moments just how we use this space for events. But what about the collections? Well, as I said, National Museum Scotland has over 4 million items in the collections. It's enormous. It covers everything from natural world to art and design to science and technology to Scottish history to cultures across the world. An enormous, enormous range. Now, all these items on screen, none of these were on display previously. And to this day, I never cease to be amazed at this. So, for example, top left, it's just one of a range of material which belonged to Alexander Fleming, the discoverer of penicillin. This, in fact, is his Nobel Prize gold medal for the discovery of penicillin, part of the collection, but not on display. Bottom left is one of a number of items donated to the museum by Charles Darwin, which he collected on the voyage of the Beagle. Again, it hadn't been on display. I don't know why. But the important thing here was Darwin presented it to the museum because he always said that the 2 years he spent at the University in Edinburgh, next door to the museum in fact, were the most influential years of his life into his later career. But again, there's also parts of the collection that result from Scots who have always, I think for two centuries, tended to go out across the world. So on the top in the centre is a slice from a fossilised tree from the Petrified Forest National Park in the United States. And you may say, what's that doing in Scotland? Well, it's really quite simple. It came to us because it was donated by John Muir. John Muir was a Scot who left with his family to make a better life in North America, aged 11. And he, amongst other things, he was responsible for, as one of the people who helped found a national parks movement in the United States. And Petrified Forest National Park is, of course, one of the earlier ones established. So these collections have great stories attached and a very strong Scottish theme, but not just a Scottish theme. But how do we make sense of these collections? Well, that's where the other strand comes in. When the museum was first established, it was always conceived as a museum of the whole world, a very strong educational mission. The first director wanted people to come and be able to find out about everything from the latest technological developments to life in other countries, to find out about the natural world. So in many ways, what we've done is go back to the beginning. When I arrived, the exhibitions were something of a muddle. There was no clear sense of order. So what we did was, relatively loosely, it put together this sense of order. You shouldn't read these areas as mutually exclusive, because in fact the collections are interdisciplinary to some extent, but it gives you an idea of how we reordered the museum such that visitors could find their way and navigate their way around this huge complex. So a quick look at a few of the exhibitions. The largest one is Window in the World, which goes up one side of the Grand Gallery. It goes up four floors, there's 800 items. And from one perspective, it's a sculptural creation. From another perspective, it's a menu of the exhibitions that lie behind. And there's all sorts of interactives dotted around this, and there's touch screens where you can find out about every object in the display. But on the other hand, on the other side of this space is a gallery aimed at adults, quite deliberately aimed at adults, a sculpture gallery, a traditions of sculpture is the theme, because all the galleries are thematic, not chronological, not geographic, making good use of the top light from the glass roof. Other galleries are very much aimed at families, quite deliberately. So this was just the early days of an installation of the Natural World Gallery with a T-Rex skeleton installed. And above that, this wildlife panorama hanging in midair with the films playing amongst all these creatures hanging in the space. And you can see in the foreground part of a huge range of taxidermy that was undertaken. Now, all these galleries are very interactive to a greater or lesser extent, depending on who the key audience the gallery was aimed at. These natural world galleries are very much family focused and indeed the most popular part of the museum. But we had much more contemplative spaces aimed much more at adults. So Earth and Space Gallery, which is everything about the birth of the universe to the birth of the life on Earth, it contains everything from samples of meteorites to telescopes. Another gallery is about the Earth itself, about earthquakes, about volcanoes, and so on and so forth. Lots of things to touch here, lots of rocks you can actually get your hands on. But again, another whole area of the museum is a whole block of galleries about cultures across the world. And a lot of these items did come to the museum because of Scots going off and bringing things back to Scotland or sending things back to Scotland. And just like the previous speakers, we've also been building links with some of the communities where this material came from. So, for example, just hanging in the bottom of the screen there is a Maori canoe. It was in Scotland because it was brought back by Sir Thomas Brisbane, who'd been the second Governor General of New South Wales. He finished his tour of duty, came back to Scotland to his home in 1826, donated this canoe to his old university, University of Edinburgh, and then it became part of the National Collections in the 1850s. However, it's never been on display. It was found in pieces in what we call the basement and then the new entrance hall. And one of our very imaginative curators had the great idea of reassembling it, but it was missing a stern post, which is actually this element here. And what she did was she commissioned a Maori artist to create a new one and to help advise us on putting together and displaying this item. So you see all the feathers there. Along the side, there's a lot of mother-of-pearl inlay, which he also restored. And he also made some films talking about the significance and symbolism of this object to his people. So again, it's a very interesting project, and that is the George Nuku, the Maori sculptor there at the opening dinner of the museum, which is why he's all dressed up. So lots of work there with indigenous communities across the world where this material came from. A huge program of taxidermy and conservation. On the left, for example, is a Chinese theatrical headdress from the 18th century. Unfortunately, it was found rather flat in a box, and it's made of kingfisher feathers. Quite an extraordinary piece of work, which had to be painstakingly restored over quite a number of months, in fact. But just going into the last part of what I want to say, which is about audiences. As I said, right at the very heart of what we wanted to do was engage with a broader range of audiences and more of them. So to that end, from the very beginning, we started planning a program for all of our public. So this is just one example of one of the new things we introduced when we opened. Someone talked yesterday, I think, about catching them young, so to speak. So this is an event, this is a new activity for parents with young toddlers, a storytelling event. But we also have other huge number of events for older people, for adults and families. On the left is one of a number of museum late events, 2,000 people at a time. We've had six of these, sold out 4 to 6 weeks in advance, charging €20 a head. It was actually the hot ticket in town, totally sold through social media. I think we could have probably put it on every single week and it'd still be full. Whereas on the right was the band of the Royal Marines, commemorating the fact we have an exhibition on about a famous Scottish admiral. So really, this Grand Gallery is very much a theatre right at the heart of the museum, with a host of different activities taking place regularly, every week in holidays and all weekends. So the outcome, well, the outcome just earlier this week when I left Edinburgh was 4.5 million visitors in the period since we opened. Now, visitor numbers aren't everything, but the first year we had about 2.4 million. It's a meaningless comparison, but that's equivalent to about half the population of Scotland and five times the population of Edinburgh. But it's not just about numbers, as we all know. It's also about the quality of the experience. So I was particularly pleased to learn, again, something else that was mentioned in the past few days about TripAdvisor. Now, we all take that with a pinch of salt, don't we? Yeah? However, a few months ago, they announced their inaugural Visitor Attraction Awards. And they announced that based on ratings by TripAdvisor reviewers across the world, the National Museum of Scotland was rated the highest in the UK, ahead of the British Museum. Not that I'm gloating. But it was rated sixth in Europe and 18th in the world. So while one has to take this with a slight pinch of salt, as I said, I think it gives some sense of visitor reaction. I think, finally, the other thing that's very different, our visitor research is showing that as we had hoped, our new displays, our new approach to engaging with visitors has actually created a significant shift in our audience. So we now have a far higher proportion of families visiting. We even have a significant increase in 16 to 25-year-olds visiting, which is normally, I think as many people know, very, very difficult to attract that age group into a museum. And we've also had a distinct shift in a distinct broadening of the social background of people visiting as well. So all these things, I think, give us confidence and courage to continue the process we started with the project in which we're now engaged. So thank you.